Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Michael Hvisdos here. He's the partner and CEO at Inquizo, and the work he does in curiosity and so much more in terms of motivation and things that make companies successful. I'm so excited to talk to him today. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this message.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Michael Hvisdos. He's partner and CEO at Inquizo, and he has more than 28 years of global experience in sales, business development, marketing, you name it. I'm so excited to have you here, Michael. Welcome.
Thanks, Diane. Great to be here with you.
Oh, well, I was looking forward to this. You've got an interesting background. You've done a lot of things. I don't want to botch it by me delivering it. So why don't you tell me how you reached this level of success?
Yeah, absolutely. It is sort of interesting. I mean, I've spent the majority of my career, probably over 25 years, leading the growth side of organizations and, you know, from roles from direct seller all the way through chief revenue officer, chief growth officer, whatever title you want to give to it. Really, then it's been the last 11 years working with businesses as a consultant and training organizations around curiosity and things like that. But worked for organizations like GE and helped them, you know, grow businesses that were acquired into, you know, big businesses like $4.5 billion. Spent some time with startups, including a really cool startup. We took, it was a renewable energy company. We took waste products, primarily waste food products and dairy manure, and turned it into natural gas and electricity. So that was a really fun job. Most of my time is spent around helping organizations, you know, grow better and helping people become more successful in what they do.
Well, that's quite a background, and that's a big job, but I love the tie into curiosity. And I know you had mentioned, and on your site, you have a bunch of articles about curiosity and its tie to performance. And what I find really hard when I studied curiosity was to find a lot of great data on showing the financial outcomes. You know what I mean? Like, if you improve curiosity, you will improve engagement, which will save you XYZ dollars. Until I worked with Novartis, and they did a pretty interesting in-house study on engagement, where they were able to move the needle from, you know, their normal engagement to quite a bit higher after doing curiosity training and that type of thing. So what kind of data are you seeing? What are you writing about in your articles, and how are you tying it into performance?
Yeah, great question. And, you know, we saw something similar when we first started getting into this. And really what drew us into curiosity was we were doing a lot of work around transformation and change with our organizations. And we saw some people progressing faster than others. And we started to ask a lot of questions around, like, okay, what makes them different? Or how do organizations adapt differently? And we started to find sort of this common thread around curiosity of the organization. And it led us into a lot of the same studies that you were looking at too. And, you know, back then, a lot of the research was around health and well-being versus in business. So that's the first thing we saw.
Right.
But, you know, Merck and Novartis and a couple others, you know, dug into it on the business side. And what they saw was pretty eye-opening, in our opinion. One of the things that they saw in the studies that they did is most people, I think it was like 22% of people, thought they were allowed to be curious at work, meaning the majority weren't allowed to be curious at work. And so it really started to be like, okay, well, what's going on and why do they feel this way? When we started to dig into it, we started to see a lot of things in business that were, and in companies that were limiting people's ability to be curious. And that to us said, we got to change that. And we got to change it in a hurry. Otherwise, things like engagement, those things are going to suffer in these organizations. So that's started us down the path.
Right. Well, you know, a lot of that data, you know, Francesca Gino's been on the show and she shared her data that from that Harvard Business Review research, which was great because, like you said, leaders think they're encouraging curiosity. And yet when you ask their followers, it's a way different number of who really believes it and that they are. And so that was my interest to find out, you were saying, you know, things that are limiting curiosity. That's what I was trying to figure out when I wrote my book, but then I realized I had to create the assessment to figure out what was stopping it because it wasn't out there. And I was so stunned it wasn't out there because all the assessments told you is if you had high or low levels, and then if you had low level, then what? So I think it's really important to look at the things that inhibit curiosity. And what I found was it was fear, assumptions, which really the voice in your head, over and underutilization of technology and environment. So FATE was the acronym that I came up with. Did those align with what you find has inhibited curiosity?
Yeah, they definitely do. And, you know, and a lot of our research pointed more towards that environment piece. And I think when you look at environment in particular, it encourages or discourages those other things you just mentioned, especially like fear, like how we engage people either walks them into the conversation or shuts them down.
Right.
And I think that's the big thing that we see in business. And you know, I don't think people overtly want to shut down the people, but when we're pressured for time, right, we don't allow people to engage and ask those questions and exercise that curiosity. When we put too much rigor and process, especially in highly dynamic environments like sales and those kinds of things, it squashes that curiosity. So all of those things that are environmental, when we're more hierarchical versus supportive in organizations, it squashes curiosity. So all of those things tie back for us, in our opinion, towards environment more than anything.
Well, it was fun to do the research because a lot of it did overlap in a way, you know, like you had a boss who told you to don't tell me any problems unless you have solutions. And then, you know what I mean? And they only recognized the problems. They didn't have the skills to give them the solution. So they shut up. And then that led to their fear that they looked stupid. And, you know, and then that, you know, led to the voice in their head saying, don't say anything because you know, last time that's what you got. And you don't know if the last job is where the environment was the problem and it just has lingered over into this, you know, maybe they don't ask questions. Last time they had a boss who would just go, oh yeah, that's a good idea. Here, you're running that and you get no money to do it. So you don't know. So I think that, you know, as you said, when we were talking before the show, you said there's a curiosity crisis in business. And I'd like to know, just what are you doing to let it grow or nurture it?
Yeah, that's probably the ultimate question there. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it has to do with how do you help organizations change the way they engage each other and the environment they create for it to go. And it's funny, we actually come in and we measure organizations. We do it through natural language. So it's pretty fascinating because people can't game it. It's sort of like we have a vocabulary, right? And we answer things certain ways, we can measure that those words and that vocabulary. So measuring it is one thing. And then that often takes us down to a path where companies want to know, like, how do I benchmark? And why we see what the best companies do, we don't encourage people to focus on how they measure up, but we start to focus with them on is differences. So even in an organization, you're going to see better, more curious people and teams. And the question really in our mind becomes, what are they doing that's different than the less curious teams? And if we can capture what they're doing and have more people do those as best practices, then curiosity goes up. At the same time, we can obviously bring in what other organizations are doing too. But a lot of it has to do with the environment they're creating and how they engage people and how they pull them into conversations. And you know, when you look at how fast business is changing around us because of technology and all those things today, and obviously the pandemic, and we can go on and on there, but you have to stay at the forefront of thinking about how this is impacting everybody's ability to buy things or do things or get things done or innovate even. So curiosity becomes so critical in business today just because of the speed and complexity of it.
Yeah, you know, and as you were saying, that made me think of how many times I teach so many entrepreneurship courses and different things still. And a lot of the times we talk about, you don't want to have to reinvent the wheel. You need mentors and different things to help you. But how do you not reinvent the wheel, get what works, and yet not end up as another Me Too product?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think it sort of ties into that innovation thing. Mm-hmm. The speed of business moves at a pace today where I think it's easy to get commoditized. But I think how we show up as organizations also makes it easy to get classified as a Me Too. And I think that ties back to the curiosity piece. And it's less about being curious about what you sell or the products that you make today, but more about like how can companies use those to achieve the goals that are most important to them in a rapidly changing business environment. And that's really the link to that. And that sort of ties to innovation. Everybody wants to put innovation as a sort of in the product bucket, but it's innovating with companies that creates a lot more value and a lot more loyalty today too.
Innovation, a lot of these words come up a lot on this show. And it was interesting, whether they're an innovation expert, an engagement expert, a motivation expert, doesn't matter what they talked about. Whenever I asked them what came first between, you know, curiosity, motivation, curiosity, innovation, everybody says curiosity comes first. And I look at it as the spark so far on the show. You may disagree, but so far, you know, and I look at it as the spark, you know, that kind of sends it down. I sometimes talk about it as baking a cake. You know, everybody wants to be productive and have all this money at the end, so that it's their cake. So if you're baking a cake, you're putting ingredients together. You're putting flour and eggs and whatever, and you're mixing it in a bowl and you're putting it in the oven and you want cake. But if you don't turn on the oven, you don't get cake, you get goo, right? And so the same thing with, if your end product is a cake, is productivity, money at the end, and they know all these other things, this motivation and engagement and innovation and all these things are mixing together, but nobody's turned on the oven and the oven is curiosity. So that's how I look at it. What do you think comes first? Do you agree with that? Or I'd love to hear differing opinions. I'm open to anything.
Yeah, we sort of back into it, and you know, innovation is the thing here. Everybody talk about, like you mentioned, and mm-hmm. and the stats sort of vary there, but probably the most recent, it's probably in the mid to high 80 percentile of even CEOs of companies say, you know, we must innovate or we die. Mm-hmm. Got to stay ahead of the competition. So I would agree with that, but I don't think they pay attention to what it takes to get them there. And you know, as you back away from innovation, you can't innovate if you're not creative, and it's impossible to be creative if you're not curious. So I would agree with you that curiosity is the precursor to all of it, but even that simple equation of curiosity plus creativity equals innovation, I think people either don't understand it or they underappreciate it. And it all starts with curiosity. And if you can't create that environment and get your people more curious, you're never going to get the performance that you need out of the organization, or you're not going to innovate and stay ahead of the competition.
Yeah, you know, it's so fun to teach these curiosity courses when I do them, because, you know, people have taken their assessment, they look at the results and they see the things that are holding them back. And I think once to move forward, you kind of have to know where you are and why you're there. And a lot of it seems kind of intuitive, but then you go, okay, now that I know this, I can create these smart goals and to get to the next level. But before we were talking, you were saying there's a scary part, two-part scary part to this innovate or die thing. Now, did we touch on what you meant by that? When we, you know, before the show, I kind of cut you off, and we make sure we cover that.
Yeah, I mean, so where we are individually, I think is critical, right? And it opens our eyes to what I can control myself to develop a different level of curiosity. We believe very strongly that curiosity is a learned muscle, and that there's really two types of curiosity. One is diversive curiosity, and I like to say that's the Google effect. So yeah. You know, there's a lot of folks, especially the younger generation, that when they don't know the answer, they jump on, you know, Google, they get the quick one, they move on. And that doesn't create a different level of thinking or a different muscle memory. Epistemic curiosity requires effort. And when I take that and dig behind the scenes and say, okay, why is that answer that answer? And what caused it to be there? And when I start to really nurture that hunger, if you will, for knowledge and curiosity, that becomes the way I start to think and approach things. And now I've created a different level of curiosity, if you will. So I think part of it is knowing where we are and what we need to do to get there. But I think even when we do the best we can individually, when organizations create environments that are counterintuitive or productive to that, they still don't allow it to open itself up. And that there is the scary part, because there's a very low level or low percentage of people that actually believe they're allowed to practice curiosity or be curious at work today.
Well, it's like any cultural issue, it starts at the top. And if the top doesn't emulate what they want, and, you know, I think it's really tough, because I've had people ask me, you know, and a lot, sometimes the answer is, if you work for somebody who doesn't get it, sometimes it's time to look for another place. But I, what I'd like to do is get the eyes open at the top, because once they get it, it's such a huge thing. I had Keith Kroc, the former CEO and chairman of DocuSign, wrote the foreword of my book on curiosity, and he really got it. He surrounded himself with people who knew a lot of things, and then he didn't pretend like, oh, I'm the only one who knows it all. He asked questions, and he really got other people more curious. I think it's really hard, and I was looking at how you had raised over $100 million in private equity, you know, and exempt bonds to finance new business ventures. And some of them that you have helped with, I mean, do you look for the culture at the beginning? Where does culture play into your whole way of doing business?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, culture is an interesting thing, because if you look at a lot of the research around culture, it'll tell you that, you know, culture is established over a long period of time. It really ties to the top leaders of the organization and, you know, how they create engagement and or direction for the organization. All of those things, I think, are true. And can you change culture? You can, but it takes a lot of time and effort, and it's slow to get there. But what we have looked at are the teams, even in organizations that struggle culturally. And what you'll find is there are teams that still are high performing despite the change or the difficulty that an organization is growing through. So then the question becomes, what are they doing different? Right? And when you really start to study them, what you see is they're creating a different environment or climate, or you can even call that microclimate, inside of that organization that is still allowing the people of their team to perform a different way. So what we do a lot of work with our leaders of those teams, especially front and second line leaders, to create those climates that will nurture curiosity. And even if the organization is in turmoil or they're extremely hierarchical versus supportive, those kinds of things where it limits the ability to nurture curiosity, they can still have a positive impact on their teams. And if we get enough teams doing that, it starts to reshape the organization in total. So climate is very different than culture. And I think a lot of leaders today need to look at, what can I do personally with my team to create a better environment for that?
Which is kind of, it was really what Dr. Maya Zelhich and I were looking at when we wrote our book on perception, because, you know, we looked at beyond curiosity, because we looked at perception as a combination of IQ, EQ, emotional quotient, CQ for curiosity quotient, but CQ for cultural quotient, and just kind of combined some of these things to look at what, you know, if you're doing business with different in different countries, and, you know, global business, different things that you're dealing with, so many different cultures and genders and things that, you know, you're, that have impacted our vantage point. And to me, just because I wrote my doctoral dissertation on emotional intelligence, I'm fascinated with, you know, empathy and how we can put ourselves in somebody else's shoes. And what we saw with perception, you know, it was an epic kind of a process. You evaluate, you predict, you interpret, and you correlate to come up with your conclusions. But all of those factors included all these things that we're talking about, you know, gender and culture and upbringing and all of that. So what part do you see perception plays in the work that you're doing, and how do you help people recognize and get empathetic to somebody's unique vantage point?
Yeah, I mean, when you look at a lot of these leaders, even with larger or smaller teams, right, we are still in direct control of the processes and procedures we ask these people to work within, or the signals we're conveying to them, or even the permissions that we grant to them to do their job. And if we can create a different way for people to navigate themselves in those environments, it becomes critical. And I think that ties back to what you're just talking about here. So it's not about letting people just go out and do whatever they want, but it's more providing the guardrails for them to operate in, and then being extremely supportive, right, in how we engage and work with them to enable them to think on their own and to perform on their own and those kinds of things too. And that naturally boosts their curiosity level. But we agree with you. I mean, there are three factors really to high performers today, and that's IQ, EQ, and CQ. And even when business leaders come to me and say, look, I've got a couple of really great candidates, who should I hire? And they're testing out really well in IQ, EQ, the first question I always ask them is, how are they engaging you? And really what I'm getting to is like, what is their CQ level? And what we have found is that if you choose the one that is demonstrating a lot more curiosity, whether you measure that or you don't, but if they're demonstrating it and they're digging into that business a different way than everybody else, that's the one that's always going to outperform everybody.
Well, I agree that it's all those, the way of looking at it is so complex. And I think that I'm always wanting to do more research to get more data, because, you know, when I talk to them, they just want that. They want to see, you know, I'm saving XYZ dollars by doing, you know, this training or that training. And sometimes, you know, you can see productivity improvements, but how do you tie it back exactly to the one thing that you've changed? And, you know what I mean? Sometimes it's tough for them, but I think it's very intuitive that we work on, you know, not the EQs and the CQs and all the Qs that we're talking about today, because if you look at, of course, we know Gallup's numbers are horrific for our engagement and everything else, you know, just that 550 billion number that U.S. companies are losing just from engagement, not to mention the money that's being lost from, you know, communication and, you know, emotional intelligence, those types of issues. It's very intuitive to me that you would work on these kinds of things if you know that this is the spark, this curiosity to everything else. So I love that you focus so much on curiosity. I just wondered if there was any area that I didn't ask you about today that you think is important to our conversation.
So let's go to the dollar thing, right? And how you measure it. Because when we found the ability to measure it through natural language, that was interesting to us. But we said, okay, how does that really impact an organization? So the next thing we took a look at was performance. And we took a performance on the sales side mostly to start with, because it's easier to measure there. We have dollars and cents and those kinds of things in rankings of people. But we also extrapolate that to even rankings of individuals, ABC in an organization or whatever method an organization uses. And we started to compare then curiosity level to performance in the organization. And what we found is that there is a direct tie between the two. Mm-hmm. Right? So what do I mean there? If I bump the curiosity up of an individual, the performance always follows it. And it doesn't really matter how you measure it, and whether it's a salesperson and meeting quota or how they rank or whatever it is, they go hand in hand with each other. So if I want better sales outcomes or better revenue outcomes for a company, it ties back to the curiosity level. And curiosity is something you can start to impact immediately. But the great news is performance will always, always follow it. So what is the payback? Well, that is the big payback that's there. The other interesting thing we found is this. It doesn't really have to do with age in an organization. And mm-hmm. you know this from running research projects, and we see this all the time. You know, we always age bracket people, and we do that to look at variability and constants and things like that. But the good news is this, we've run enough people, or we measure enough people to be able to actually take that age equation out, right? So age bracket and, like, you know, what level do you, or what range do you fall into? People always get scared with, but we don't need that anymore. What we found is this: curiosity has more to do with, or impact of curiosity has more to do with tenure and position. And it sort of ties back to Liz Wiseman's book on rookie smarts, right? Tenured we are in position, the more likely we are to depend on what got us to where we are versus to stay up on the learning curve. So the more we can even take our tenured people and keep them up on the learning curve and nurture that curiosity, the more likely they are to keep their performance at a really high level too.
Yeah. And Liz talked about, she and I were on a panel recently. We were on a couple boards together, and her work is really impressive. And I think that it's, you know, do you have any of the research that you talked about in terms of productivity, that do you post that at all on your website? Or I'm curious where your numbers go, that the research you get.
Yeah, we definitely do post it in our articles, and it's out there for people to take a look at. Interestingly enough, you know, you talked about early on the curiosity article, but with Harvard, we submitted everything to Harvard about 3 months before that article. And they came back to us and said, you know, love what you're doing, but we're going to have to pass on you.
A little too late. Huh?
Yeah. Well, and they came out with their own, and a lot of people came back to us and said, like, what do you think about the Harvard thing? Or, you know, are you disappointed that you didn't get published? And we're like, absolutely not. Right. The more people that are talking about this, the more we start to open companies' eyes to it. So we were actually really excited about even Harvard's research, because it actually said the same things that we were talking about. And the more awareness we can create with businesses, the better off we are.
Well, I may need you to send me some of your research, because I'm always looking for more. I'm always looking for more. And it was great having Francesca on the show talking about her Harvard research. And she's in Thinkers 50, which is a group. I'm part of their Thinkers 50 radar. And in that whole group, they're super curious. And I love that it's out there. And I hopefully get to see more of your research as well. And I think a lot of people will want to know how they can find that, find you, and learn more about what you're working on.
Yeah, the easiest way is jump on our website, www.inquizo.com. And then you can certainly reach out to myself or my business partner, Janet Gerhardt, and we can, you know, talk with you more specifically about it. But we put all of our articles and publications out there for people. And there's some video snippets out there too, if people just want to hear us talk about curiosity and share some of our points of view there out there. One of the most recent things that we did last year was a series of articles on how do you get people to pay attention in this COVID world that we're in, when the access to people is more difficult today. So specifically in email and those kinds of things. Like, how do you capture someone's attention and create that curiosity with them so they actually engage you? So that's even out there.
Well, I'm curious. I want to read that one. And I think this was such a great conversation. And it's just, it's wonderful to hear that you've got so much data to back up what I think is such a huge topic. And I'm glad more people are getting interested in it. And love what you're doing. And it was so wonderful having you on the show, Michael.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I'd like to say the same back. I mean, it's been, you know, wonderful to read your book and to follow the research that you're doing around curiosity too. And, you know, the more of us that start to pay attention to this, I think the more impact we're going to have on not only companies, but people too. And that's why we do what we do.
Yeah, I really hope so. And this was so much fun. And we will be back right after this message.
Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com.
You know, I get so many great guests on the show. Sometimes I want to take some little bit of time to talk about some of the research I do. So I'm going to talk to you today about perception and some of the work I did with Dr. Maya Zilahich, who is also one of my people I've worked with at the Forbes School of Business. And she's been really great in this process of researching how, you know, perceptions process in our mind, our opinions and our version of the truth and our biases and how we live. And, you know, what's in a rose? Well, would it smell as sweet by any other name and all that we read about? And so we looked at what can we do with perception in the workplace to discuss it, because we kind of looked at it as a combination of IQ, EQ, CQ for cultural quotient, CQ for curiosity quotient. And we thought, you know, I really think that this is something that they're not talking about enough in the workplace. So, you know, we talk about is perception reality, and to what extent are our perceptions true? Well, they're just our perceptions, right? But what is reality to us may not be reality to them. And so I think there is a truth to some extent, but what's real and all that, we started to get into this analysis paralysis thinking about it. And we thought, if we're thinking like this, we need to showcase what others have done to try and look at this, because the world's changing. We've seen The World is Flat by Thomas Friedman's great book, right? And we know that what we used to think is the reality of everything that we thought we could do, now it's different. We're becoming more connected, and we know that there's a lot more issues with the recent global tragedies. And so as companies are trying to do work in a global .com industry, it's just a lot different of how we look at things than when I originally got into the workplace or when Maya got into it. So we're looking at some of this, just our belief systems of what shape us, and both consciously and unconsciously, because if we know that, we can be more responsive and respond to this multicultural, multi-language world in which we're living. So if we can monitor our perceptions and guide them towards where we want to go or where we don't want to go, and understand what other people believe and maybe not necessarily agree with everything that they believe in, but that we, you know, we can understand that and see where they're coming from. And that's that way we manage our perceptions, and we're able to build empathy, which is a big part of emotional intelligence. And maybe, you know, you can't walk a mile in my shoes, but we can kind of have a better appreciation for what it would be like to do that. So we kind of looked at what was available in terms of assessments out there of how can we like test and validate and do all these things with that. And we came up with a perception power index, which goes along with the book, The Power of Perception. And those are the kinds of things that we're going to talk about today. I just think, you know, we come into this world with this predisposition of how we view and interpret things. I mean, imagine if you're born where you are now compared to if you were born somewhere else. I mean, we know that with twins, they're different if they were separated at birth. There's just a different upbringing. And so we have this cultural impact on how our behaviors, our beliefs, and everything that we relate to, it's impacted by our social and ethnic and age group, everything. And we're seeing that there's a lot more conflict right now in the world. And I think a lot of it is because we don't really understand each other that well. Something that we just don't even think about is acceptable or, you know, not questionable here in the United States might be something very questionable in another culture. If you're wearing a mini skirt in Brazil, is a lot different than if you're wearing that in Saudi Arabia, for example. So we have to appreciate where other people are coming from and see where maybe we're allowing our culture, our society, dictate what we're thinking and what we're perceiving. I've had Joe Lurie on the show. He's got a great book, I should say, a mind-opening journey across culture, where he talks about a lot of this, or writes about, I should say, all the different perceptions of things that he's found in different cultures. Maybe like eye contact in Western cultures is maybe candor and confident, but you go to Africa, they don't want to do that because your eye contact with a person of authority, you got to worry about respect. And there's a lot of different issues when you're talking about Western culture versus other cultures. And in Asian cultures, they might use a calculator to negotiate price of things, but you might not want to do that in some other areas because it may seem disrespectful. So looking at different areas is really fascinating. Just even how certain hand gestures mean one thing, may mean A-OK in one language and maybe be insulting in another language. So, or another culture, I should say. So a lot of studies look at Western culture versus other cultures, and I think that is worth reviewing. But now we know that, you know, there's a lot of stereotyping going on. We're trying to get away from that. We're trying to get away from biases. I mean, we have biases. Bo Lotto talked about that on my show. I hope you listen to that episode about how you need it. You know, you can't live without some kind of bias to give you some decision-making ability. But we have to pay attention to unconscious bias. And we got to be careful that we don't come across as arrogant or condescending. And, you know, just saying something, keep it simple, stupid, might mean one thing in one language. And, you know, we have that as a saying, and it's not meant to be insulting. But if you tell it to somebody else, it could be very insulting. So I think these are the kinds of things that we were looking at when we decided, you know, we needed to look at cultural quotients and IQ and CQ and, you know, our drive, our motivation, our knowledge, our cognition, our metacognition, and all those things to look at how we come up with these actions or behaviors. And do we have to adapt to customs, or should they adapt to ours, or should we be more tolerant of differences? And so I think, you know, change is a big thing that we teach in business classes, and being proactive to it is also important. And we know that we have these teams where there's in-groupers or out-groupers, and we want to try and get people to get along well. I know I've had Amy Edmondson talking about teams and teaming and how people get along, and a lot of it, collaboration is about having curiosity to ask questions and learn from each other. So we want to look at the path that we're on that's similar, but also understand the path that we're on that's not so similar. And some of the things that impact that sometimes are things like spirituality. Whether you're religious or not, it could be different, but some people, you know, have this impact of how important their spirituality or their religion is to them, where other people might be agnostic or atheist, and that could completely shape your whole perception of the situation at hand, where you might accidentally insult someone without even realizing it, of how important something is to them. And I don't think a lot of people give a lot of thought to the differences of how much strength that can have in their ideas and their things that they question or don't question. But it really can have a big impact, because we inherit a lot of beliefs from our family, and, you know, we personalize our beliefs. We take things that work for us, maybe don't work for us, and we make something around what works, you know, in our situation. And that can make us think we're right and they're wrong, and vice versa. So that is a problem in the business world if we don't examine what, you know, is shaping what these people are coming up with or not coming up with. And so having personalized beliefs are fine, but we have to recognize that, you know, even though Stephen Covey says, you know, spiritual renewal is one of the habits that are essential to effective leadership, we have to look at, you know, what's your greater purpose? What do they think is their greater purpose? And what are our values or our ethical principles? And what are theirs? And what will our legacy be? And what is theirs? And so those are the kinds of things that we researched in terms of, you know, how people use their religion, spirituality, and that. But it was also fun to look at gender to see the differences of how people look at paintings. There was a comment we put in the book. Two strangers, a man and woman, were visiting an art gallery and found themselves standing next to one another, staring at a painting of an old country estate, replete with an elderly man sitting in a rocking chair on a front porch of a mansion and with various barns and outbuildings and serving as background, right? The woman, without prompting, commented, "What a beautiful painting, so serene and peaceful, a beautiful blend of man and nature." The man commented in response, "That barn looks like it's in dire need of a paint job." Okay, so we both look at the same thing, but we see different aspects, right? There's not that one's right, one's wrong. It could be the opposite way around. It could be the man seeing the great thing, the woman saying the opposite. We don't want to stereotype necessarily, but it's interesting to see that men and women do see things a little bit differently. There are psychological differences in, you know, that these have been documented, including differences in their brains. So I think, you know, we hear gender bias, and we know studies show women viewed differently, treated differently, paid differently, and we know there's a predominance in the number of men compared to women in executive positions. And so those are the kinds of things that are really important to leaders to recognize, that we're talking about, you know, we have to know the origins of all this and why we see things through these different lens. And we know that men's brain is structurally different than the female brain. And that, I think that's kind of a fascinating thing to look at in itself. So we're not going to exactly see things in the same way. And there's a book, a New York Times bestseller called The Female Brain. It's Dr. Luann, I hope I say her last name right, Brinzendine. She's a neuropsychiatrist, I believe. And, you know, she also later wrote The Male Brain. And so she guides you through how the brains of each gender differ and how they shape our behaviors from the time we're infants all the way into adulthood. And the women's perceptions and behaviors are different to men's, mostly, she says, due to hormones, which, you know, we do have different hormones. We know women have more estrogen, progesterone, even though we have testosterone, not as much as the men. And it goes all the way back to some of these hormones from, you know, that it's just how we are influenced by them. And I talked to Tom Peters on the show. That's a great show if you get a chance to look at it. And he talked about the female brain, and he recalled an article, I think it was from Duke University basketball coach Mike, I never say his last name, Krzyzewski. Anyway, it was the Sunday Times magazine section. He described how that coach, often referred to as Coach K, would bring his wife to all the team meetings, and he said the reason was that she would see what was going on in the players' lives that he just didn't notice. She would notice a smell of a problem of a girlfriend 100 miles away or some kind of distraction, and he didn't think men psychologically saw those things, and he found it really fascinating as an observation. So I think, though, you know, there are differences, and if we pretend like we're not different, that doesn't work. We get uncomfortable, and if we look at that as one thing being better than another, that's also uncomfortable. So, but I think it's really important to just recognize that these things are part of us, that we're intended to be different. We're not intended to be exactly the same, and life be super boring if it was that way. So just thought that would be something that you talk about in the workplace of what we can get. We know that the percentage of women in the workplace is increasing. We know that the rate of women occupying key roles in the workplace is on the rise. And we know that women are being hired into leadership roles more often than they were as CEOs, of course, at an increasing rate. We'd like to see it, of course, higher. And we know that women are bringing in different perceptions into the workplace. And then those are just different aspirations. So it is an interesting thing to look at, that how genetically wired we are, you know, we're wired differently right from the birth. And these differences are spawning this ground for this history of beliefs and stereotypes of how we're taught to view each other, and we're just carving a different road for ourselves, the women versus the men. And I think that's really important to know that we're evolving. And to do that, when we're doing that, we're impacted by our intelligence in this process. And if we look at intelligence, it's, you know, we talk about IQ and EQ, and if we're thinking of intelligence as what we know and how we apply what we know that we need to be able to use our intelligence to just understand how to relate with one another. We know that our intelligence evolves in different ways, and our perceptions evolve in different ways. And so there's this perceptual intelligence of fluid versus crystallized intelligence comes about. And I think that there's some great work by Raymond Cattell, who talked about that. If you ever get a chance to read, you know, some of his work, I think that, you know, there's all these different types of how what we learn and how it changes over time is a very important thing to look at. Also, Howard Gardner's very heavily cited in the area of types of intelligence. And used to be we just thought we had one kind, right? But he studied all these different types of abilities that we have. I mean, you could have naturalistic intelligence, music's intelligence, logical mathematical intelligence, existential intelligence, body, kinesthetic, verbal, linguistic, intrapersonal, visual, spatial intelligence, interpersonal intelligence. I mean, the list goes on and on. So I think that, you know, to say if somebody's smart is kind of a hard thing to do because there's these different types of ways of being smart. And then how do you value that intelligence and what's important in your culture for that type of intelligence? So that was interesting to us as we went through all the different ways that we grow and learn and just apply what we know. And then we also looked at emotions as in emotional intelligence in that aspect as well, because I had written my doctoral dissertation on emotional intelligence, and that's such a huge area. It was so great to have Daniel Goleman on the show to talk about emotional intelligence. And if you haven't listened to that episode, I highly recommend it. But emotions play a big part of how we make decisions. I mean, if you want to talk about empathy, is a big part of emotional intelligence. And if we have empathy, we ask, you know, sometimes that ties into curiosity, that we're asking questions to learn more about each other. And our emotions can be different across cultures. I mean, if you have different studies between Japanese and American subjects, you know, they found facial expressions and nonverbal behaviors varied significantly between them. But it's interesting that certain emotions, I had Paul Ekman on the show, who the TV show Lie to Me was based on his work. There's certain expressions that we all make that are the same, whether you're blind or not. And I thought that was really fascinating. My father was born blind. So I really think it's interesting what things we have similar and then other things that are completely different. And it's just conceptually different based on the way you grow up and the influences around you of how you respond to your emotions. And your emotions can make you perceive failure differently either. And, you know, some of us have the fight or flight response. Some of us will, you know, run from it, or some of us will run to it. But most of us have that sense that failure is not your favorite thing, right? So our perception of failure can really influence how much we explore things and ask questions. It gets back into curiosity again. And I tell a story in my talks, and Maya and I write one in the book about just different experiences where sometimes you're in a sales presentation where you get your rear end handed to you, and you know, you might be on a call with your partner and your partner thinks it's the worst thing in the world, where you might think it's the best thing because you've learned everything you need to know now to fix your next presentation. And if you don't learn these things, sometimes your perception will get you down and you'll quit. So failure, you have to learn from failure, I think. And if you don't, you're going to end up being the glass half empty kind of person, and you won't move forward. You'll just stay where you are or move backward. And that's what we're trying to avoid by understanding perception. So The other things that we looked at when we were looking at perception was, you know, whether, again, if it's your reality or not. And I think that looking at some of the perception experts, especially Bo Lotto, I love his TED Talks. I know he was on the show and he talked about a lot of great things on the show. But if you're wanting to know perception versus reality, I would look at some of that because it's kind of fascinating. And I think talking about perception, you really need to talk about collaboration, because collaboration is a, you know, required skill set right now in the workplace. And if you're being hindered by your perceptions, there's so many variables, like, you know, think of the questions we ask ourselves. Does this project intrigue us? Does it motivate us? Do we like our teammates? Do we like our leader? Do we like the role we've been given? And you look at all this, and if you're getting mixed reasons for why you like something or don't like something, a lot of it could be your perception of it. When we talk about collaboration, I always think about Amy Edmondson's TED Talk, because that, of course, ties into how they got the Chilean miners out in that disaster. These people were able to work together and collaborate because they maybe had different perceptions, but they knew that it was like life or death, literally, in this case, to help people get out from under that rock. So I think understanding that perception is critical to collaboration and to getting people to work together and being innovative and creative is really interesting, because right now we're talking about how much we have problems with. Gallup says we're losing $500 billion a year on engagement. We know that people want to be collaborative. And if we don't have this ability to get along, that's going to be huge. And, you know, we want people to be creative and see things differently. I love, you know, in the Dead Poets Society movie, Robin Williams, you know, had the students get on top of their desk to look at life in a different way. And he said, to make life extraordinary, you have to make a difference, you must see things differently. And I think that that's a really key point, that a lot of people always are looking at things from their vantage point. They don't get on top of their desk. They don't look at things from another way. And I know I've done a lot of training classes where we've given Legos and we've had people build things as teams in collaborative ways. And it's just fun to see them get ideas from each other and go, huh, I would have never looked at it that way. And if you maybe aren't a big fan of teams, sometimes it's really helpful to get on a team with people who are completely different than you are. Because if everybody thinks the same way, life's really boring. And it helps to look at things from a critical thinking standpoint, to do research. How do these people do this? How have they made it successful? What facts support their argument? What's the source of their information? And how did they come to that conclusion? And then we're back to curiosity again. And I think that those are the kinds of questions we need to ask ourselves. And I don't think we get enough of that. I think that there's a lot of people who just want to take things at face value based on what they've always known and what supports their values that they've always had. And that's kind of common for people. I mean, you watch the same either CNN or Fox or whatever that supports your values because it makes you comfortable. But it really is important to get curious and kind of get outside. You know, our perception suggests we know something, but our curiosity proves that we don't, right? So we need to know what we don't know. And I think a lot of people aren't asking enough questions. And that's the kind of thing that in the book, Cracking the Curiosity Code, it's a huge part of changing the culture in organizations. And I often talk a lot about that to groups, because if we can ask more questions, we can get better at decision making. And so it's, you know, decision making can be really challenging. I love a quote by Deepak Chopra where he says, if you obsess over whether you're making the right decision, you're basically assuming that the universe will reward you for one thing and punish you for another. If you think about that, you always think you have the right or the wrong thing, right? But it's not necessarily the case. There's shades of gray. Not everything is black and white. And that's what I find particularly fascinating in the research that we did. And, you know, if we're trying to fix all the things in work, we're trying to fix engagement. I mentioned before that you're losing 500 a year, according to Gallup, that, you know, when people are financially invested, they want to return, right? But when people are emotionally invested, they want to contribute. And so that's what we need to do, is get people emotionally invested at work and contributing. And part of that is to ask questions and to understand each other better. And then if you're asking questions, again, we're back to empathy, which is a big part of emotional intelligence. And then we're getting that perception of the other person's ideas. And we're seeing it not just from our own standpoint, but from theirs. And I think that to improve some of the questions that we need to ask to improve engagement are like, do my employees feel they're growing in their work? Are they being recognized for their work? Do they trust the company's on the right track? And so those are some of the things that lead to really great communication. I had Kevin Cruz on the show, and he has a great book and information about engagement. And I think that that's really helpful. And all this is so that we can be better leaders, right? And better employees, both. And I think that we have to sometimes suspend our beliefs and be agile and, you know, look in some of the words that we hear a lot about vulnerability. You know, Brené Brown has made a lifelong career out of that. And I think that a lot of people don't feel comfortable doing that. So that's what led to our interest in maybe, you know, looking at what the perception process is and how can we manage our perceptions. And so we looked at, you know, creating an assessment would be important and kind of an epic decision of, you know, how can we help people understand that what they go through? What is the process look at like? And we found it's about evaluating, predicting, interpreting, and, you know, reshaping and or actually correlating one's perceptions. And so the EPIC acronym we came up with is evaluation, prediction, interpretation, and correlation. And those are the things that if you take the perception power index that you will find out, how are you doing in those areas? What could you do to improve your EPIC process? And, you know, I think it's very similar to if you've taken the Curiosity Code Index. It's very simple. You get your results right away, and you can find out a lot more about how well you go through this process and what kinds of things are helping or holding you back. Because if you get a baseline of, okay, so this is how I am at this, then you know how to move forward. Let's just look at some of these, because evaluation, you know, you're going to examine, you're going to assess, and you're going to do a lot of these different things that you can recognize if you're open to thoughts or ideas. You kind of look at it from your own perspective of your self-awareness. I kind of think of this one as more of that in that respect. And if you apply this element of emotional intelligence, this self-awareness, then you're going to get along better and you're going to be able to be more aware of how you come across to other people, because that's a lot of a problem. I see a lot of people don't recognize body languages or issues or tone or if they're typing in all caps. There's all these different things they can do of how they come across and they don't realize it. And then they can predict how the other person's going to ask and act. And then in a way, that's another part of emotional intelligence, is their interpersonal awareness of are they able to understand the other person's, where they're coming from, what their perception is and their capabilities and their abilities and how they make decisions. And that is very challenging to predict what other people are going to do if you don't look into what they're doing and have empathy and ask questions and have that sense of emotional intelligence. And it's only then that you can make your interpretation. And your interpretation, you have to consider how all of this impacts their decision of how the curiosity comes into this. You know, you're making assumptions and you're looking at how their fear is impacting them. And I think a lot of this really ties back into their culture of how were they raised. And we know that behavior and different things are rewarded or not rewarded in certain systems. And so we need to look at that. How did their culture shape them? And how did the company culture shape them? So I think it's about assessing and understanding your own emotions for the EPIC part. But the I part, that part is more about putting it collectively together and to interpret what you know. And then you end with your conclusions. Your correlation is your final C of the EPIC process, because now that you have all this, you can come up with your solutions, your conclusions. After researching your facts, this is kind of the critical thinking aspect of it all. And, you know, we know that that there's so many great ideas that come out, but if you know, you don't go to the part where you end it with coming up with the idea, with actually taking what you've learned in this group setting and changing a little bit of your behavior so you can have a win-win situation, you haven't come to any kind of conclusion that's going to be good for everybody. So I think that those are some of the main points that we make in what we're talking about in this epic process, in this power of perception. And I thought that this would be something really critical to share. You can take the Perception Power Index at drdianehamilton.com, and all the assessments are there. You can take the Curiosity Code Index, you can take the Perception Power Index, you can even take a DISC, an emotional intelligence test. A lot of that is all there. If you don't see it in the drop-down menus at the top, there's more menus at the bottom. And I hope you contact me if you have any questions, and I hope that this helps you understand perception a little better.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, I'd really like to thank Michael for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on this show. If you've missed any past episodes, please go to drdianehamilton.com. You can find everything there. And I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio.